Hello, Ávila. How is it going here, the train station?
Show yourself, Basta! Long life, Christ the King!
See you soon. Salute. This conversation appears in the book Espoir by the French writer André Malraux, and it underlines two facts about the coup and the beginning of the Spanish Civil War. The first is the importance of the phone. The second is the chaos present at the beginning of the conflict. The government realized with calls like this what was going on. Good morning to everyone. I'm Pep, and this is the Spanish Civil War. In this channel, and for the next 3 years, we will follow week by week the Spanish Civil War, its battles, and the Holocaust that it provoked. This episode will be a bit longer because condensing the first moments of the coup has been a bit difficult. Staying with French writers, Camus considered that it was there that his generation learned that one can be right and yet be beaten, that force can vanquish spirit, and that there are times when courage is not rewarded. By others, as the British historian Preston, the Spanish Civil War was both a prelude of the Second World War and an Holocaust. It can also be considered the consequences of Spanish political conflicts deeply rooted in society, the first clash against fascism, a crusade, and we get short of names. Even if the seeds of war, as the seeds of defeat, need their time to grow, we could say that the undeclared war that raged during the spring, and therefore the Spanish pressure cooker, reached high temperatures this past Monday, when a group of assault guards, after failing to get other important right-wing leaders, murdered the opposition leader, Calvo Sotelo. We will talk about deeply during the coming week. The coup has already been programmed to take place between the 10th and the 20th of July, but the violent death of the man that once said that the army was the backbone of Spain was what the undecided looters were waiting for. The murder, although it was a reprisal for the killing by the fascist militia of an assault guard officer, Lieutenant Castillo, was publicized by the right-wing media and by the official history after the war as a political murder ordered by the government. So, the stage was set. The parliamentary session of this past Wednesday was a gorgeous mess. The leader of the Carlist, I love Dalmau paintings of them, left the parliament accusing the government of Calvo Sotelo's deaths. Robles, leader of the main conservative party, backs him. He, that is also aware of the coup, sends an advice to the popular front. They will be the first ones to fall in the upcoming clash. So, the hot Friday afternoon of the 17th of July, 1936, the coup takes place. In Africa. It was programmed for the day after, but the treason of a Falange member, the Spanish Fascist Party, forced the plotters to advance it. There, the coup succeeds with almost no difficulties. Melilla, Ceuta and Tetuán, the main cities, fall easily. General Romerales and General Gómez Morato, the highest ranking officers in Africa, are taken prisoners by Colonel Gazapo, a member of the Falange, and General Bartomeu, that declares the state of war at 5 p.m. in the name of General Franco. There is scattered fight in some places, like the air bases of El Atalayón, where the commander, Virgilio Leret, remains loyal to the government and resists for some time against the second tabor of infantry. A sergeant and a rebel infantryman are killed during the assault, and may be considered the first casualties of the war. In the Tetuán Samia Ramel air base, after resisting during the night, Ricardo de la Puente Bamonde, cousin of General Franco, managed to sabotage all the planes before he surrenders. Romerales, Morato, Leiret, De La Puente and Arturo Álvarez, High Commissioner for the Spanish Protectorate in Morocco, will be shot. During the afternoon, the news of the coup reached Spain. General Villabrile is informed, but he leaves home when he cannot verify the information. General Miguel Núñez Pardo, as General Chief of the Aeronautics, phones all the airfields. they must stay alert. The government, in fact, tries to react. Issues the order to attack the rebels with the planes that are stationed in Sevilla. Even two transport planes are converted into bombers. Issues also the order to arrest suspicious generals, as Varela, known defender of the military intervention, and sends the fleet to blockade the strait. But the bombing of Tetuán backfires. Even if the Legion barracks is not damaged, also the mosque and some buildings near it are also affected. 15 people die, and 40 more are wounded. A Muslim uprising breaks out inside the uprising, but is well managed by Bekder de Atienza, that blames the Republic and then gets the support of the Muslim authorities for the rebel cause. According to Bieber, when the sun will rise tomorrow, 189 people will have been killed by the rebels in the first hours of the uprising. For Preston, they will be 225. The morning of the 18th, Franco replies from Gran Canaria to the telegram sent the day before by the rebels from Melilla. It is important to point out how Franco, being a key figure of the war, reached Gran Canaria. The 5th of July, Ignacio Luca de Tena, director of the right-wing newspaper ABC, ABC, asked Luis Antonio Bolín, his English correspondent, to get a plane in order to take Franco from Gran Canaria to Africa. Bolín was given a white check by Joan Marc, Franco's banker and a key figure in the 20th century Spain. So he hired the Havilland. You can see the original plane in a recent photo here. They left London the 11th of July and arrived at Lisbon the 12th, where Bolín met with General Sanjurjo, the man that will be in charge of Spain after the coup. A veteran general that has been forced into exile because he had already attempted a coup in 1932, but it failed. After a stop in Casablanca and another one in the Spanish Sahara, the plan reaches Gran Canarias. A delegate of Franco meets with Bolín, but Franco is not there. He's in Santa Cruz de Tenerife and has no permit to reach Gran Canaria, so he cannot move. Or he can. The 16th of July, General Armando Balmes, commander of Gran Canaria, expert marksman, suffers a tragic accident as he shoots himself trying to unblock his pistol, holding it with his stomach. It seems you could reach the rank of general in the Spanish army and be recognized as an expert marksman without knowing how to use a pistol. Historian Moisés Domínguez, Francisco Franco Foundation, and the official regime narrative will bid for this version accident. The historian Ángel Viñas, instead, will point out in two books that there was no accident. It was Franco's first murder. With the death of Balmes, Franco will be able to reach Gran Canaria with government permission to assist to the funeral of his colleague and eventually join the rebels the next day. You can choose what to believe, if the accident theory or the assassination one. We've talked about a telegram before this digression. Franco's telegram is sent the 18th in the morning from the naval base of Cartagena, where a group of officers joins the coup but is defeated by the sailors, to Madrid, in order to be resent to all the garrisons. But there, Benjamín Balboa López intercepts the telegram. He's a member of the Union of Republican Anti-Fascist Military Men. Benjamín surpasses the chain of command that he knows partially involved in the coup, sends a telegram to the Navy Minister, Military Attaché, and after arresting his superior when ordered to radiate Franco's message, contacts all the ships of the Navy, informing the radio officers to stay alert, because maybe, just maybe, their officers were involved in the coup. Must have been a hard day at work for him. The 18th morning, the Prime Minister announces the coup in Africa, but not in the mainland, and at the end of the cabinet meeting giving it little importance. He then refuses again the help from the trade unions. He believes he can handle the rebellion and threatens to shoot everyone that gives weapons without his approval. But he's afraid, as his Republican colleagues. They are afraid of giving the weapons to the trade unions to arm the people. That delay on taking this decision could become a big mistake. The government, in fact, is shooting blindly, sends generals to convene other generals that arrest them as soon as they arrive, as happens with Núñez de Prado, arrested by Cabanellas, or trust in officers that already had aligned themselves with the rebels. The CNT and the UGT convoke a strike like in 1932. Also during the morning of the 18th, Queipo de Llano, together with other rebel officers, reaches the office of his superior in Sevilla and arrests him. He goes after to the barracks of the 6th Infantry Regiment and arrests its commander, loyal to the Republic. Then he attacks the Parker artillery factory, slaughtering the workers that tried to reach the complex in order to wet weapons. Even if the narrative of the regime and himself will tell after that Queipo de Llano conquered Sevilla with 20 men, he had at his disposal and ready for the coup 4,000 men. He just needed to replace the officers that would not join their side. After taking the palace of the civil governor and killing the assault guards, he focuses on the workers that barricade themselves in the neighborhoods of Triana and La Macarena. At 10 p.m., Queipo goes on air for his first broadcast, using the same radio the workers used to call for the strike that same morning. As in Sevilla, during the 18th of July, other southern cities with garrison, Cordoba and Cádiz, where Varela is released as reinforcements arrive from Africa with destroyers Churruca, fall into rebel hands after a brief battle in some governmental buildings. In Malaga, after a brief fight between the rebels' garrison and the assault guards, the troops are sent back to the barracks by General Pachol, and so the coup is kinda crushed. In Jaén, even if we will hear about its civil guards in the future, there is no coup for now. On Sunday the 19th, the day when the uprising was planned, the domino effect continues. Last night, at 10 p.m., Casares Quiroga, the Prime Minister, resigned. During the night, Martínez Barrios, a Republican, is tasked to create a new government that excludes socialists and communists with the aim to negotiate with the rebels. He speaks with Mola, but the director refuses to negotiate. Barrios resigns then, and José Giral, former Navy Minister, constitutes a new government and issues the order to give weapons to the people, as he declares the dissolution of the army. This delayed decision meant that, in just a matter of hours, the power of the government will virtually disappear. That's the main reason for the delay. Giral also sends a telegram to the neighboring France asking for help as the rest of the fleet is sent to blockade the strait. In Oviedo, as two columns of miners are sent to Logroño that had sided with the rebels, as Calahorra, Coronel Miranda, the officer of the army, betrays the Republic and sides with the rebel side as prepares himself for holding a siege. He'll declare a state of war tomorrow. In Gijón, also tomorrow, Colonel Pinilla will follow his steps. In Santander, the 23rd Infantry Regiment refuses to join the coup. Meanwhile, the Basque country remains under the control of the Republic, with the exception of Álava. In Navarra, where Mola, the director of the coup, has its office and the support of 8,000 Carlists, the coup succeeds. After proclaiming the state of war, Mola dispatches three columns, one headed to Zaragoza to reinforce Cabanellas, another one towards the Basque coast, and the third one under the Colonel García Escámez to Madrid. In Castilla la Vieja, already during the afternoon of the 18th, a group of assault guards rebelled in Valladolid. The general of the 7th Organic Division, Molero, was wounded and arrested by General Saliquet, that takes charge of the division and joins the rebel side, occupying during the night of the 18th the key buildings of the city and declaring the state of war during today's morning. The other units of the division, garrisoned in other places, followed the orders issued from Valladolid. In Burgos, the head of the 6th Division, Batet, is arrested by rebel officers and the division joins the rebels, like the cities of Logroño and Salamanca. You can see that the coup is on full swing. Aragon, as we've said before, Cabanellas Ferrer arrested yesterday General Núñez de Pardo and was dismissed by the government together with Franco and Queipo de Llano. He's the only divisional general involved in the coup, and that's something remarkable, as it seems the coup does not come from the top-ranking officers. As Cardona and Graham point out, the rebel strength resided in an officer class whose aspirations had been cut off by the budgetary restrictions of the Republic. Zaragoza, so, falls quite easily despite its huge but unarmed anarchist movement. Huesca and Teruel fall too. In the Balearic Islands, Godet declares the state of war and then flies to Barcelona, where the rebels are sure they will succeed. The night before, As the president Companys refused to give weapons to the workers, the workers' unions decided to provide themselves and prepare for the upcoming coup. They cooked homemade bombs and assaulted a couple of weapon stores and 4 ships. As the troops start to leave their barracks with double cognac in order to put down an anarchist uprising, all the factory sirens and vessel bells of the port start howling. The workers meet them at the start and harassing the columns as they try to reach the strategic buildings, or they directly block them in the starting positions. The assault guards and the Mossos d'Esquadra have also taken strategic positions in the route the soldiers should follow. In the middle of the fray, an assault guard and workers charge under the fire with their weapons in the air against an artillery battery. They explain the soldiers that officers lied to them. The soldiers then turn their cannons. With all of this resistance and with more and more citizens coming out of the houses every minute, the soldiers are driven back to defensive positions. As Godet arrives, the situation for the rebels has already been lost. After midnight, the civil guard and Aranguren and Escobar side with the Republic. Godet surrenders, but the Atarazanas barracks will hold until tomorrow. More than 500 workers lie dead in the street. The popular Olympic Games, proposed in response of the Olympic Games of the Nazi Germany, had to start today in Barcelona, and more than 200 athletes joined the fray. In Valencia, the man in charge of the coup waits to see the evolution in Barcelona and Madrid, and as the news of Godet's surrenders arrive, he does not move. Murcia also remains under the hands of the Republic. In Castilla la Nueva, Guadalajara and Toledo are still under government hands, even if Colonel Moscardó refuses to send ammunition from the military factory to Madrid. In Cuenca and Ciudad Real, the coup failed, but in Albacete, it succeeds. Extremadura is split in half. Cáceres, that's under the 7th Division, Valladolid, joined the rebel side. Instead, the brigade from Badajoz stays loyal to the Republic. In Madrid, the capital, during the afternoon, Colonel Fanjul joins the rebels from the mountain barracks, but he cannot go out, as besieged by armed citizens. The rest of the capital units either don't join the coup, or the rebel officers are arrested. The exception is the transmission regiment that flies to rebel zone in Valladolid. The rebels continue their advance as they take Sanlúcar de Barrameda and Algeciras. Meanwhile, the fleet that has been sent to block the strait experiences mutinies. The sailors of the Churruca, the radio was broken so Benjamin could not contact them. After taking the rebel troops to Cádiz, mutinies and imprisons their officers. The sailors of the cruiser Libertad mutinied when the officers disobeyed the order of bombing Cádiz and then headed to Tanger, after hearing that the sailors of the cruiser Cervantes mutinied too. Without the fleet, and with the strait block, Franco cannot cross to the mainland with the Army of Africa. So today, he sends Bolin to Italy in order to ask Mussolini for help. Wherever the government gave weapons to the workers and some police or military units remain loyal to the government, the coup failed. And with the issue of weapons to the population, there were spontaneous acts of rage in some places against those who were perceived as oppressors. Military men, priests, landowners. But I would like to remark this spontaneousness as fruit of non-existing government. If we consider Max Weber's classical definition of state being it, human community that successfully claims the monopoly of the legitimate use of physical force in a given territory, during this week, the Spanish state has almost ceased to exist. On the other hand, the white terror we will be tracking in the rebel side was institutionalized, aimed at shocking the working class with extreme violence. In the words of Mola, it is necessary to spread terror. We have to create the impression of mastery, eliminating without scruples or hesitation all those who does not think as we do. So, with a coup ongoing and the state disappearing, we leave you. During this week, as the roots of war, of rage, are more than 200 years old, we'll proceed with some introductory videos about the history of Spain in the 19th and early 20th century. You can also check the Great War first video, our inspiration, in the following link. Keep tuned, and in 7 days, you will have another episode of the Civil War. We encourage you also to leave your comments in the section below, but we already give the advertisement. Spanish Civil War is still a conflict today in Spain, so hateful messages and the respectful one will be cancelled. We thank Eugenet for his colored photos. If you got photos that you would like to share with us or materials, we will welcome them. Please don't forget to like the video and subscribe us. If you enjoyed it, share it, because we have to bring light to the history of Spain. Goodbye.